So it's good to be with you. This is Jason, and don't forget my website, jasonburnspreacher.com, Facebook. We're looking at who wrote the Gospels. We looked at J.P. Holding's article, the date and authorship of the Gospels, and we were just looking at Roman history and how we confirm a writer of the wrote Roman history, Tacitus, and the same principles that we can use for the Gospels. But now we're going to look at who wrote the Gospels. This is from truthnet.com. Like many books in the Bible, the Gospels nowhere contain a direct reference to the authorship of each and appear to be anonymous. On the surface, some Greek manuscripts simply identify these as kata, Matthew, and according to Matthew, kata, Mark, and according to Mark, and so on. The phrase according to Matthew, according to Mark, according to Luke, and according to John could mean they were written anonymously from testimony gleaned by their named sources, but what other sort of evidence is there to attest the authorship? Evidence from early sources. The name Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were associated with the Gospels of the same name from the very early days of the Church Fathers. No other authors have been suggested for them. Skeptics will attribute them to anonymous source only and cannot produce an alternative author. Third, literally thousands of manuscripts of the original Greek exist, as well as thousands of translations into other languages. All manuscript evidence points to the name, authors. None dispute this. The early church father Irenaeus, Tertullian, Origen, Eusebius all name Matthew as the author of the gospel attributed to him. In fact, Irenaeus knew Polycarp, disciple of John personally, and identified all four gospel authors by name. Papias identified by name both Matthew and Mark, and the casual way he does so suggests these authors were well known. For Mark, the best evidence against comes from Papias, who stated Mark, having become the interpreter of Peter, wrote down accurately whosoever he remembered. It was not, however, in the exact order that he related the sayings of deeds of Christ, for he neither heard the Lord or accompanied him. But afterwards, as I said, he accompanied Peter, who accompanied his instruction to the necessities of his hearers, but with no intention of giving regular narrative of the Lord's sayings. Wherefore, Mark made no mistakes in thus writing some things as he remembered them. For one of the things, he took special care not to omit anything he had heard and not to put anything fictitious into the statements. Matthew put together the oracles of the Lord in the Hebrew language, and each one interpreted them as best he could. Other early church leaders also attribute Mark's gospel to him, such as Irenaeus, Clement of Alexandria, Tertullian, Origen, Jerome, and Eusebius. The author of Luke is attested by Origen, Eusebius, Athanasius, Gregory, Nyssans, and Jerome. Internal evidence suggests Luke as the author. The author of Luke and Acts are one and the same. Luke chapter 1, 1 and 4, Acts chapter 1, 1 and 3, and the use of Theophilus mentions the former account. The author of Luke, Acts joined Paul as demonstrated by the use of the first person plural we and Acts 16 and 20. Luke is named by and accompanied Paul on his second and third missionary journey and was with him during his first announcement, Colossians 4:14, Philemon 24, and second imprisonment, 2 Timothy 4:11. These three taken together point to Luke as the author of both third gospel and of Acts. Lewis Burkhoff in his New Testament Introduction states the voice of antiquity is all but unanimous in describing the fourth gospel to John. The Monarchian sect called Epiphanius the Allegi forms the only exception as noted above. Both Irenaeus and Polycarp, according to Eusebius, attribute John's gospel account to him. Burkhoff further provides the following piece of internal evidence pointing to John as the author. The author was a Jew. He had an intimate acquaintance with the Old Testament. He knew them not only in the translation of the Septuagint, but in their original language, as is evidenced from several Old Testament quotations. Moreover, the style of the author early reveals his Jewish nationality. The author was Palestinian Jew. He clearly shows that he is well at home in the Jewish world. He is intimately acquainted with Jewish custom and religious observance, with the requirements of the law, and moves about with ease in the Jewish world of thought. The writer was an eyewitness event, he relates. He claims this explicitly, if not already, in 1:4, and beheld his glory in John 1:1-3, certainly in John 19:35, and he that saw it bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true that you might believe. This claim is corroborated by the lively and yet sublime, simple manner in which he pictures the events, by many definite chronological data and naming of localities to which we may already refer, by the great providence given to certain individuals with whom Jesus came in contact. The author of John was the Apostle John. He often makes mention in his Gospel of a disciple whom he never names, but to whom he constantly refers as the other disciple, as the disciple whom Jesus loved. In John 13:23, John 18:15, John 19:26, John 20 verse 2, etc. At the close of his Gospel he says of him, "This is the disciple which testifies these things, and we know that his testimony is true." Who is this disciple? The evangelist names only seven of the disciples of the Lord, the five that are not named being John and his brother James, Matthew, Simon, Canaanite, James the son of Alphaeus. Now it is evident from chapter 1, 35 to 41, that said disciples was one of the first ones called by the Lord. And these, according to Mark chapter 1, verse 16, 19, were Peter, Andrew, John, and James. The first two are explicitly named in John chapter 1, 41, 43. So that the one whose name is suppressed must have been either John or James. But we cannot think of James as the author of this gospel, since he died as a martyr's death in the early AD 44. Therefore, John must be the writer. One general note concerning authorship. Leon Morris, in his commentary on Matthew, Pillar New Testament Commentary, makes the following observation. It is routinely pointed out that none of the ancient manuscripts of this gospel say that Matthew was the author. This argument should be looked at more closely than it usually is, despite the fact that it is almost universally accepted by modern scholarship. It takes no note of the fact that whether in ancient or modern times, few books give any indication of authorship beyond the title page. The title page indicates the author quite clearly, and there is no reason for repeating the information anywhere else in the book. Now, none of the oldest manuscripts of this gospel have been preserved with the title page intact, but from the earliest ones that do have it onward, the book is invariably ascribed to Matthew. We must face the fact that throughout antiquity, it is accepted that Matthew wrote this gospel, and there is no other name in the tradition. Morris' point is well taken. It does not follow that the lack of title page in existing manuscript means we cannot accurately determine the original author of any of the gospels. Regarding the authorship of Matthew specifically, in addition to evidence from the early church leaders noted earlier, Morris further notes, there remains the fact that in ancient tradition, this book is universally ascribed to Matthew. To name anyone else as the author is to affirm that the name of its true author was forgotten within a comparatively short time, about 50 years, and another name substituted, especially since Matthew was not, as for our information goes, especially prominent either among the 12 or in the early church. Accordingly, there seems to be no reason for assigning him to such an important writing, unless in fact he wrote it. Conclusion. There is sufficient reason based on hard evidence to believe that the gospel accounts were written by the authors of the same early attestation, multiple attestation, no alternative authors named, nor compelling arguments to the contrary. Muslim apologists who choose to use Christian scholars such as Bart Ehrman to support their view would do well to become familiar with the sloppy scholarship and steer clear of him as an authority. Okay, that's an article on TruthNet. Some thoughts on the authorship of the Gospels. I hope that's been a help to you. And we're now going to look at the Gospel of Barnabas.